next result is show that addition and scalar multiplication are jointly continuous. So in this result, our purpose is to prove that addition and scalar multiplication are jointly continuous in normed linear space. Now for proof, solution, let N be a normed linear space. As we discussed earlier, normed linear space and sequence xn and yn, these are sequence in N such that xn approaches to x and yn approaches to y as n approaches to infinity. Now our first part is addition is jointly continuous. To prove the addition is jointly continuous, our purpose is the sum of xn plus yn is approaches to x plus y. It means now we take from this xn sequence plus yn sequence, this is sum, minus x plus y, right? So this can be written as xn minus x plus yn minus y. So we are working in nonlinear space, and nonlinear space satisfy the triangle inequality. So this is less than equal to xn minus x plus yn minus y, right? So this is possible because of nonlinear space, and this is here we use the triangle inequality. Now we can apply triangle inequality because in nonlinear space it satisfy the triangle inequalities. Now from this, if xn approaches to x, then it implies norm of xn minus x approaches to 0. Similarly, from this yn approaches to y, it means yn minus y approaches to 0 as n approaches to infinity. So we used this value in equation number 1. So it implies 0 plus 0, which is equal to 0 as n approaches to infinity, right? So it implies norm of xn plus yn minus x plus y, it approaches to 0 as n approaches to infinity. Clear? So this is a, from this we get it implies xn sequence plus yn, so it approaches to x plus y, so it implies addition is jointly continuous. Addition is jointly continuous. Now our second part is scalar multiplication is also a jointly continuous. So prove in case of scalar multiplication. So we take one xn sequence which is convergence to x and alpha n sequence which is convergence to alpha. So alpha n is a sequence of scalars and xn is a sequence of vectors, right? So in case of scalar multiplication, so we take one is xn sequence of vector and second is scalar multiplication. So here I take alpha n which is convergent to alpha, right? So here it is xn. So one sequence is xn which is in n and second sequence is alpha n which is a sequence of scalars, right? So this is a sequence of scalars. So xn approaches to x and alpha n approaches to alpha. My aim is our claim alpha n into xn, it approaches to alpha x as n approaches to infinity. That is my aim, that is my purpose. To prove this, I take alpha n xn minus alpha x. So this can be written as alpha n xn minus alpha n x plus alpha n x minus alpha x, right? So we can write it in this way. This can be written as norm, alpha n is common, xn minus x plus alpha n minus alpha into x. This again in normed linear space triangle inequality is valid, applicable. So by using triangle inequality, so this is less than equal to norm alpha n xn minus x plus norm of alpha n minus alpha into x, this values. So this is less than equal to absolute value of alpha n norm of xn minus x plus norm of alpha n minus alpha into norm of x. Clear? Now in the given part xn approaches to x, right? So from this norm of xn minus x, this term approaches to 0, right? And because alpha n is a convergent sequence and every convergent sequence is bounded, so this is a bounded, so here it is a bounded, clear? So this term approaches to 0 and this term is bounded, then the entire term approaches to 0 in this case. And here in this case, as alpha n approaches to alpha, so this norm alpha n minus alpha, this norm approaches to 0 into norm of x. So total term approaches to 0 as n approaches to infinity. So total term approaches to 0 as n approaches to infinity. So what we get? We get from this alpha n, from this we get alpha n xn minus alpha x, this approaches to 0 as n approaches to infinity. So it implies alpha n xn approaches to alpha x. So what we get? We get scalar multiplication is jointly continuous. Scalar multiplication is jointly, which is a jointly continuous, right? So this is a proof of this result. After that result, the next result is, in a non-linear space, every Cauchy sequence is a convergent sequence. So every Cauchy sequence is a convergent sequence. Clear? So in a non-linear space, again, N is normed linear space. So remember that in the entire chapter, N is a non-linear space. Our purpose is every convergent sequence is a Cauchy sequence. So first I take a convergent sequence. Suppose this Xn is a convergent sequence in N. What do you mean by this? It means this Xn sequence converge to X as N approaches to infinity, right? Now apply the definition of convergent sequence. What is the definition? For epsilon greater than 0, there exists a positive integer capital N such that N greater than equal to capital N, it implies norm of Xn minus X, which is less than epsilon. So our requirement is epsilon by 2, so we take less than epsilon by 2. Clear? So to prove it is a Cauchy sequence, we take let M and N greater than equal to N. So by definition 1, what we get? We get Xm minus X less than epsilon by 2 and Xm minus X less than epsilon by 2, right? So this is by equation number 1. Now to prove a Cauchy sequence, here I can write it as Xm minus Xn. This can be written as norm of Xm minus X plus X minus Xn. This is by using triangle inequality. So this is Xm minus X plus X minus Xn. This values are. Now this term, by using this less than epsilon by 2. So this term is less than epsilon by 2. Again this term is less than epsilon by 2. So the total term is less than epsilon. So this is possible when M and N is greater than equal to capital N. So here we get norm of Xm minus Xn, which is less than epsilon for every Mn greater than equal to N. So it implies this Xn is a Cauchy sequence in N, right? So it means every convergent sequence, it implies Cauchy sequence, right? But converse is not true, So here we proved every convergent sequence is a Cauchy sequence. Now next is very important result, which is called a Holder inequality. Now to prove the Holder inequality, there is very important lemma that we want to prove, that is, if A is greater than or equal to 0, B is greater than or equal to 0, and 1 by P plus 1 by Q equal to 1, 1 less than P less than infinity, then prove that AB is less than or equal to A raised to power P over P plus B raised to power Q over Q. This condition is also called Q is conjugate to P, right? So this is very important result. This is very important lemma. So that is very useful for a Holder inequality. Now, in the given part, A is greater than or equal to 0, B is greater than 0. If A equal to 0 or B equal to 0, right? Now, in this equation, left hand side is 0, right hand side is 0, then we have nothing to prove. In that case, result is obvious. In that case, result is obvious. Clear? Because it satisfies the equality. 0 is equal to 0. Now, for the second case, if either A and B are non-zero. Now, in this case, A is non-zero and B is non-zero. So, now we will prove result for this condition. Now, we define a sum function. We define sum function f of t. Suppose this is f of t, and it is a function of t, 1 minus lambda plus lambda t minus t raised to power lambda, where 0 is less than lambda less than 1. Yeah, lambda is some parameter, some value lies between 0 and 1. So this is the equation number 1. Now, to prove this lemma, our purpose is to find the minima or maxima of this function. Clear? To prove, our purpose is to find the extreme value of this function. So, to find the extreme value, we need first derivative and second derivative of function. So, first derivative f dash t, which is equal to lambda minus lambda t raised to power lambda minus 1. So this can be written as lambda is common 1 minus t raised to power lambda minus 1. Right? So this is a first derivative. Now for second derivative, so this is minus lambda into lambda minus 1 and t raised to power lambda minus 2. Clear? So its derivative is 0, its derivative is minus lambda into lambda minus 1 t raised to power lambda minus 2. To find the extreme values, so we take f dash t, which is equal to 0. So it implies lambda into 1 minus t raised to power lambda minus 1, which is equal to 0. Now lambda is non-zero. So what we get? We get t is equal to 1. So here t equal to 1 is the extreme value of this function. It may be minimum, it may be maximum. To check whether it is a minimum and maximum, so we take the second derivative at this point here. Now what is this? This is a minus lambda into lambda minus 1. Clear? Now, in this part, 0 less than lambda, 0 less than lambda, less than 1 from this. So, first, since lambda is positive, so minus lambda is a negative. Clear? This is less than 1. Second, from this, 1 minus lambda is greater than 0 and lambda minus 1 is less than 0. So, this term is negative and this term is negative. So, product is positive. Clear? So, it implies its f dash t is greater than 0 at t equal to 1. Right? It means it has minimum value at the point t equal to 1. Clear? So, from this, what we get? We get f of t which has minimum value, minimum value at point t which is equal to 1. Clear? So, it has minimum values at point 1. It implies this function for any parameter, for any value, is always greater than f of 1. Clear? Because it has minimum value at this point. Clear? So, the functional value, any functional value, is always greater than equal to this values, because it is the minimum values. F of 1 is the minimum values. If f of 1 is the minimum values, now from this it implies, from this is a function, this is a function 1 minus lambda plus lambda t minus t raised to power lambda. Clear? Now, using these values, clear, to substitute that value in this equation. So, we have two things, f of t which is always greater than equal to f of 1. So, what is f of t? F of t is 1 minus lambda plus lambda t, and next is minus t raised to power lambda, which is greater than equal to f of 1. Now, when we substitute the value of t equal to 1, so this value will become a 0. Clear? So, check in equation number 1. Substitute t equal to 1. When we substitute t equal to 1, so we get this values. So, here we get 1 minus lambda plus lambda t minus t raised to power lambda is greater than equal to 0. What is lambda? Lambda is any value, which lies between 0 and 1. So, I choose lambda is equal to 1 by p, because it lies between 0 and 1. If 0 and 1, so this is 1 minus 1 by p, this values, plus t by p, clear, minus t raised to power 1 by p, which is greater than equal to 0. So, when we substitute lambda in this equation, clear? Now, what is the value of this term? This term, since we know that 1 by p plus 1 by q, which is equal to 1. So, this term will be 1 by q. So, 1 by q plus t by p greater than equal to t raised to power 1 by p. So, what we get? We get t raised to power 1 by p less than equal to t by p plus 1 by q. Right? So, this is our value. Now, to prove our result, we substitute put t which is equal to a raised to power p and b raised to power minus gamma. To prove our result, we substitute this equation. Now, what we will get? We get this values. This is a raised to power p and b raised to power minus gamma. Now, substitute in this equation. So, we get a raised to power p, b raised to power minus gamma and raised to power 1 by p, so which is less than equal to a raised to power p, b raised to power minus gamma over p plus 1 by gamma. Clear? So from this we get a raised to power simple a, and here it is b raised to power minus q by p, and this is less than equal to a raised to power p over p into 1 by b raised to power q, clear, plus 1 by q, this value. Now multiply by b raised to power q on both sides. Now to prove our result, multiply by b raised to power q on both sides. So we get a into b, this is q minus q by p. If base is same, then there is addition of power, so which is less than equal to a raised to power p by p plus this is b raised to power q by q. So what we get? So what is the value of this equation? Now we know that 1 by p plus 1 by q, this is equal to 1. So our requirement is q minus q by p. So multiply by q on both sides, we get q by p plus 1, which is equal to q. So what we get? Q minus q by p, which is equal to 1. Now substitute this value in this equation. So what we get? We get a b raised to power 1, which is less than equal to a raised to power p over p plus b raised to power q over q. Clear? So which prove our result. So that is very important result. That is very important lemma. So it satisfy AB is less than equal to a raised to power p plus b raised to power q over q. So which prove our result. Now this lemma is useful for a Holder inequality. Now we will use this result for a Holder inequality. So what is the Holder inequality? So that we will prove. Now this is the statement of Holder inequality. So what is Holder inequality? Holder inequality is if x is equal to x1, x2, so on up to xn, n-tuple form, and similarly y is again n-tuple form, this is n-tuple form, and 1 is less than equal to p less than infinity, so it satisfies this condition. Yeah? So here we have this condition. Which condition is? It satisfies this condition. What is the condition? Here I is running from xi yi absolute value less than summation of absolute value of xi power p then raised to power 1 by p. Similarly here in term of q, this term is called norm of xp. This is norm of x base p, and this term is called norm of y q. So remember this notation also, okay, this term which is called a norm of xp, because here it is p, clear? Here it is q, so this term is called norm of y q, and p q are conjugate to each other, means 1 by p plus 1 by q, which is equal to 1, also 1 less than p less than infinity. Now, our purpose is to prove the Holder inequality by using the previous lemma. Clear? Now, again, if x is 0 or y is 0 or y equal to 0, so result is obvious, right? Then in that case, left hand side is equal to 0 and right hand side is equal to 0, so result is obvious. Now, what we proved? We proved in the lemma by using the same condition. What is that lemma? That lemma is AB less than equal to A raised to power P over P plus B raised to power Q over Q. So this is the one value of A and P. If there are number of terms, so here I can write it as AI, BI, here AI and here BI. Clear? So these are the term of this values. Now put in this case, put AI which is equal to absolute value of xi over norm of x base p. Similarly, in case of bi, bi which is equal to norm of yi over norm of y base q. Clear? So this can also be, what is the value of norm x and norm y? So here I write it as norm xp, which is a summation of absolute value of xi p and raised to power 1 by p, right? And raised to power 1 by p. So similarly, in this case, norm of yq, which is this summation of yi raised to power q and again raised to power 1 by q. So similarly, in case of this values, so what we get? We get this is in this and raised to power 1 by p. So this is the norm of x. If we take the power p, and what is x and y? So what is x and y? X is a x1, x2 and xn. This is n triple form. What is y? This is in term of y1, y2 and yn. Clear? That is already in the statement. So this is the value of x and y. Now substitute this ai and bi in this equation that we derived from the lemma, that is equation number 1. If we substitute these values, what we get? We get xi over norm of xp, this, and this is yi over norm of yq, which is less than equal to 1 by p, this is in bracket. So what we get? Ai raised to power p. So it means here this value is xi raised to power p over norm of xb and raised to power p. This remember, clear? So this remember, raised to power p plus 1 by q, similarly in the same case. So again norm of yi, so raised to power q over norm of y q raised to power q, this values. So we get this values. Now taking summation on both sides, here I take summation, I is running from 1 to n. Here I take summation, I is running from 1 to n. And here I take summation, I is running from 1 to n. Clear? Now see the definition of norm of x and norm of p. From this, if I take the power p, So this will be summation. So it means, what is this? This is a norm xp raised to power p. Clear? So which is same as this values. So what is this? What is this from this checker? This is a norm xp raised to power p. So this value and this value are equal. If these are equal, they cancel to each other. Similarly, this value and this value are equal. So again, it cancel to each other. They cancel to each other. So what we get? We get this is a this term, which is a summation of xi yi over norm xp into norm y q, and this is I raised to power 1 to n, this values. So which is less than equal to 1 by p plus 1 by q, because this term is cancelled with this term and cancelled with this term, and then total sum is equal to 1. So what we get? We get, because this term is non-zero, this term is non-zero, so total product is non-zero, so multiply by this value on both sides. So what we get? We get norm xi yi, I is running from 1 to n, which is less than equal to norm xp norm y q. Clear? So this is our result. So which is a proof of a Holder inequality. So this result is called a Holder inequality. So this is very important result expected for examination. So after that, we will prove a Minkowski inequality, and after that we will prove a Cauchy inequality. All the three inequality are very important, and they are useful in the examples in which we want to prove is this kind of space are Banach space, this kind of space are not Banach space. Clear? So this is a Holder